it's going to be extremely difficult because you've got to persuade people that the future will be okay at a time when you're fearing that the pandemic will hit your district next. So it's a tremendous challenge, but it's something which we have to do. I don't think we have a choice in this matter. See, I think the first and the most important thing is to balance the risk of an outbreak with the risk of losses of livelihoods for 700 million people. Right. Right? I think that's one of the biggest differences between India and the rest of the world, where we have a big outbreak risk, but we also have a big risk with respect to the livelihoods of literally everybody. But really, 700 million people are very acutely affected by the hard measures that we've taken to control this. So to the first order of the day, therefore, remains is how do you now get through with, you know, your daily life, restore as much of economic capacity, livelihood capacity of the population as possible while you are still under the shadow of the pandemic. So one of the proposals we have made, and I think many other people also have made, is to localize the control measures at a district or a locality level and concentrate on hotspots. So if you see one district one locality as having a lot of cases which are turning up, you would focus your control measures, lock down that district, put the adjoining districts on alert, but let other districts which are further away and further afield to continue with economic livelihood, right? And that's going to be the most important. And I think we're going to hear from the Prime Minister in a day or two on how that will go. But our recommendation always has been to color code into red, blue, yellow, and green, and focus on the red in terms of lockdowns and control measures, but allow the greens and the yellows to get on with life and livelihoods as to the extent that is possible. Now, this is a balance, and this is a very hard balance because you could be yellow as a district today, but you could become orange and red very, very quickly, in which case the government should have the ability to quickly turn around and impose control measures. So what we've been saying is that you need an ability to look at it as a knob, not as an on-off switch, right? Lockdown or non-lockdown is not the right way to look at it, but look at it as a knob that you can dial in, dial up and dial down according to what your risk is. So that's number one. The second thing is the government has to figure out how to deliver relief to a lot of people who are literally destitute now because of the lockdown, right? We are already talking about 40 to 50 million job losses in the last 4 weeks, probably 200 million people in the informal sector suffering serious losses of income, right? And you've got to figure out how to get these people out on their feet. And we are talking about spending as much as 3 to 5% of GDP in terms of cash transfers and relief measures to individuals and small businesses who can then get back on their feet as quickly as possible. The third is to align these short-term measures towards a longer-term reconstruction plan. Now, we know in India that we had a slowdown long before the COVID-19 pandemic hit us. And we had a bigger problem even before that, which was how do you employ 20 million people every year, because we had a huge demographic dividend, but we were not able to provide livelihoods and jobs to 20 million on the scale of 20 million people every year. So now you've got to do all of these things together. You've got to find jobs for people. You've got to create an economic reconstruction plan, and you've got to get out of the slowdown which you had even before this thing started. So a huge economic package is required. This is something which I have called the Indian equivalent of a Marshall Plan, where on the scale of what the West did for Europe after the Second World War, where you the state spends humongous amounts of money in building infrastructure, in terms of reconstruction, building up capacity, building up healthcare capacity, both human infrastructure as well as physical infrastructure, in order to kickstart the economy and get it out of the rut. Now, here's an important point. The COVID-19 pandemic has created both a supply shock and a demand shock, which means investors are unwilling to invest in any kind of industrial capacity because they're not sure whether the demand will be there. And people are not consuming enough and will not consume enough because they're worried about the future. They're not very sure what's going to happen in a year or two. So you have a supply shock and a demand shock hitting you at the same time. And you've got to address both of these things together. And one, you know, you can go, you can make a far more elaborate plan. But one simple measure which the government can do is to signal that it's going to invest a lot of money I'm talking about 5 to 10% of GDP in infrastructure over the next few months and years, which will give industry the confidence to invest and consumers the confidence to consume. It's going to be extremely difficult because you've got to persuade people that the future will be okay at a time when you're fearing that the pandemic will hit your district next. So it's a tremendous challenge, but it's something which we have to do. I don't think we have a choice in this matter.